ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وسلم فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وشر الأمور محدثاتها وكل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة قال الله تعالى في القرآن المجيد بعد أن أقول أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا قال الله تعالى أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم وما خلقت الجن والإنس إلا ليعبدون قال الله تعالى أيضا وإذا سألك عبادي عني فإني قريب أجيب دعوة الداعي إذا دعان فليستجيبوا لي وليؤمنوا بي لعلهم يرشدون قال الله تعالى وقال ربكم ادعوني أستجب لكم إن الذين يستكبرون عن عبادتي سيدخلون جهنم داخرين رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي نستغفر الله ربنا من كل ذنب ونتوب إليك ربنا زدنا علما اللهم بارك لنا في رجب وشعبان وبلغنا رمضان آمين يا رب العالمين الحمد لله Allah, before I start, I want to just quickly translate some of the ayat I recited in the beginning of the khutbah. Allah says, وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسَ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ That we have not created human beings and jinns, jinns and human beings, except to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the Prophet says, الدُّعَاءُ مُخُّ الْعِبَادَةِ The best form of worship is dua. That we are created to worship Allah, and the best form of worship, alayhi salatu wasalam says, is dua. And Allah also says, وَقَالَ رَبُّكُمْ دُعُونِي أَسْتَجِبْ لَكُمْ And your master says, call me, ask me, I will respond to you. أَسْتَجِبْ لَكُمْ إِنَّ الَّذِينَ يَسْتَكْبِرُونَ عَنْ عِبَادَتِي سَيَدُخُلُونَ جَهَنَّمَ دَاخِرِينَ Whoever does not call me and does not worship me, he is arrogant. And a person who is arrogant does not enter Jannah. A person who does not make dua is a person who is arrogant. And will be entered into Jahannam. So the big question that we're dealing with in today's khutbah is people always have this question in their mind. I always make dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I always make dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but it's never answered. I don't see it. What's the problem? Why is that? Does that mean Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala didn't like me? And if Allah is there, why is He answering my call? What's the matter? So inshallah today I'm gonna discuss what is dua? And what is the best way to make dua? And what is the wisdom and how dua works? So first of all, we have to understand one thing. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِنِّي وَنَحْنُ أَقْرَبُ إِلَيْهِ مِنْ حَبْلِ الْوَرِيدِ That we are closer to the human being than his jugular vein. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, every single thing that we do, Allah knows it. Allah knows it before even we do it. And Allah knows what happens in our sleep, we don't even know what happens to us in our sleep. That's how close Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is. And our du'as are never rejected. Du'as are, Allah always responds to our du'as. And what is the proof of that? Allah says in the Qur'an, وَإِذَا سَأَلَكَ عِبَادِي And when my servants ask you about me, Ya Rasulullah. When my servants ask you about me. Who are the servants of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Allah is a رَبَّ النَّاسِ قُلْ أَعُوذُ بِرَبِّ النَّاسِ He is a master of all people. Therefore, if He is a master of all people, so all the people are His slaves, His servants. Whether we say it or not, whether we worship Him or not, We are slaves of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Whether a person is a believer or not a believer, he is abd and Allah is the Rabb. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, when my servants ask you about me, Ya Rasulullah, I am near. That's how the ayah goes. He does not say, tell them I am near. He says, I am near. What's missing here is that we don't need someone in the middle to talk to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That when my servants ask you, the Prophet, Allah speaking to the Prophet, when my servants ask you about me, and then he's like, I am near. To show that how close Allah is to us, to the point that he doesn't even mention, tell them, I am near. If you have to go to Rasulullah, you can directly go to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and Allah is listening to us, you know, as we speak. Inni qareeb. He says, Ujibu da'wata da'i idha da'an. I answer to the call of the caller whenever he calls. And the word ujibu is interesting. In Arabic, ujibu comes from if'al. If'al, like the same pattern as Islam, right? Submission. Ujibu is immediate. Any word that comes in this pattern, ujibu, ijaba, is immediate. There's immediate and completeness involved in this word. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala answers us immediately with not a millisecond delay, and He answers to us completely. Ujibu. Da'wa, the call of the caller, ad-da'i. He does not say answer to the call of a Muslim. He does not say answer to the call of a believer. Ad-da'i, whoever calls Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, sincerely Allah will respond to them. Ad-da'i has the al on it, which means the caller. It means Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows. When you put da on something, al on something, it means you know someone. It's ma'rifa, which means Allah knows us in and out. I know that person. Every single one of you, I know from in and out. What situation you're going to, what you're going, you know, what is your feelings, every single thing, no one can listen, Allah knows. Ad-da'i, I know that caller and I'm going to respond to him, I will respond to him. Ad-da'i, idha da'an, whenever you call him. You know, some people, you know, especially people who are of high status, you can call them whenever you want, right? And you may know them, they may not know you. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is laysa kamithlihi shay. There's no one like Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah is that being, He's above everything, yet He's always available to pick up your call. إِذَا دَعَانَ, whenever you call Him, He responds to you. And He knows you, which is not the norm. إِذَا دَعَانَ, then what does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala want from us? فَلْيَسْتَجِيبُوا لِي وَلْيُؤْمِنُوا بِي. The condition is, you have to respond to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You have to respond and answer to His call, meaning to obey Him, to follow the Rasulullah, to follow Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and you know, follow His commandments. فَلْيَسْتَجِيبُوا لِي and وَلْيُؤْمِنُوا بِي and believe in Him, لَعَلَّهُمْ يَرْشُدُونَ, so that they may be guided. Beautiful ayah just on dua. And what's interesting, another thing about these two words here, we talked about ujibu, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala answers what? Immediately and completely, right? That word was used for answering. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala uses the word for us responding to Allah, answering to Allah, He uses istajaba. Istajaba is not complete and it's not immediate. Istajaba means to try. Istifa'al in Arabic, the word istifa'al pattern, is to try to ask. Like istighfar is to try and ask forgiveness. To try to respond. So what Allah is telling us, you don't have to respond to me immediately. You don't have to respond to me completely. Try your best. Like at least give it a try. Do something. You know, go close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's all I want from you. I don't expect perfection from you. You're not the Rabb. I am the Rabb. I will do ujibu and you do istajaba. Right? SubhanAllah, beautiful. فَلْيَسْتَجِيبُوا لِي وَلْيُؤْمِنُوا بِي لَعَلَّهُمْ يَرْشُدُونَ. Right? That's how Allah subhanahu. And these ayat come right after the ayat of Ramadan. After talking about Ramadan, Allah subhanahu talks about this. Why did I pick this topic? Because Ramadan is around the corner. And it's the best way to get, you know, to know how dua works and what it means to make dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So, another thing that's interesting is that anytime you call someone in Arabic, you have to use ya, right? If you call someone, like, you know, get someone's attention and say, ya walid, hey, boy, right? You're calling a boy, but ya is to get someone's attention, right? In other languages, we also have this, right? When you call someone, you say, like, yo, hey, excuse me, right? These are different particles of calling someone. So in Arabic, you have ya, right, to call someone. And in the Quran, you see whenever Allah calls us, He says, ya ayyuhal ladheena amanu. Oh, you who have believed, why? We are distracted. So He needs to get our attention first. Ya, get our attention. The ya is for getting attention. Right? Someone is distracted. Hey! And then you call the person's name. Right? So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when He calls us, He grabs her attention and then he calls her name. Like, Ya Ayyuhul Muzdammil, Ya Ayyuhul Muddathir, Ya Nisa al-Nabi. Right? He uses Ya. But the beautiful thing about this is that when we call Allah in the Quran, we never say Ya Allah. We never say Ya Rabbana. What do we say? Rabbana Atina. What? Ya is removed. Why? Do we need to get Allah's attention? No, we don't. Allah is always listening to us. 24/7, every single second He's listening to us. So we don't even use Ya for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Right away we get to the dua. Rabbana. As if He's already listening to us. And Rabbana, not Rabbuna, because Ya is affecting it. Ya is removed. The tronical beauty. So that's the show that Allah is very near to us. He's always listening to us. This is a matter of us turning to Him and having that yaqeen. Now, every single dua is accepted, is answered no matter what. The way it manifests is different. The way it shows up is different. Right? And the Prophet says there's no person who asks Allah for anything except that Allah gives it to him or keep some evil away from him. So when we make dua, one thing that can happen is it happens right away. Or what can happen is something bad was about to happen to us, some evil was supposed to happen to us, and because of the dua, that evil will be removed. So the way it's manifest is only known to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Right? If you ask something, maybe that's not good for you. That's why Allah did not give it to you. And so the Prophet says to the Sahabas, when you make dua, my companions, increase in your dua. Ask the best thing. Because you're not asking someone, Ya Allah, I just want this one last thing. You know, after this, I don't want. Who are you talking to? Why are you speaking like that? You know, this is the last thing. Only this thing, Ya Allah, please, please. No, Allah is the Rabbu Samawati wal Ard. When you ask Him for, you know, the end thing, end degree. Right? Ask Him for Jannah. Don't ask for Jannah. Ask for Jannatul Firdaus. Ask Him for not one car. Ask for 10 cars. Don't ask for one house. Ask for 10 hours. Whatever you're asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, don't ask for this job. Ya Allah, multiply this 100 times. And Allah can give it to you. Ask Allah for a lot. And so the Sahaba says, okay then, Ya Rasulullah, we will ask Allah a lot. And then the Prophet says something beautiful. Allahu Akthar. Whatever more you ask, Allah is more than that. Allah is more than that. Allahu Akthar. So increase in your dua and never stop. And so one other thing that people have, a mindset people have is, when my prayers are not answered, does that mean Allah is angry with me? I make dua to Allah, but I don't see it happening. Does that mean Allah is angry with me? And one thing you have to understand, there is no connection between Allah's anger and your dua not being answered. There is no connection. And what's the proof of that? Look at Nuh alayhi salam. Nuh alayhi salam give da'wah for 950 years. Did he make dua for his son, do you think, as a father? Yes, he made dua for his son for 950 years plus. He did make dua that Ya Allah help him, right? Give him, bring him to Islam. Like any father would make dua for the children or any parent. But did the dua get answered? Did he accept Islam? No. Does that mean his dua that Allah subhanahu doesn't like Nuh alayhi salam? No. It's up to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who he turns, who makes him accept Islam. If Allah knew something was good inside him, he will turn into Islam. So just because your du'as are not answered does not mean Allah subhanahu doesn't like us. Look at Ya'qub alayhi salam. Did Ya'qub alayhi salam make du'a for all his sons? Yes, he did. Did Ya'qub alayhi salam make du'a for his son Yusuf alayhi salam for so many years to the point that he lost his eyes? He lost his eyes just making du'a and crying over that. Does that mean Allah doesn't like Ya'qub alayhi salam? No. Allah does. Allah wants him to go through those things. And there's wisdom behind it. Why that happens, wisdom behind it. Just because your du'as are not answered, never ever feel that Allah is angry with me, I'm not going to make du'a. The one who does not make du'a is the arrogant person. And you know, making du'a doesn't mean that your problems will be removed. Just because you make du'a, it does not mean your difficulties have to be removed. The difficulties are part of life. Allah wants you to go through it because there's a greater benefit of that hardship. For example, look at Yusuf alayhi salam. Right? We all know the story of Yusuf alayhi salam. Yusuf alayhi salam, as a young boy thrown in the well. What did that poor boy, innocent boy do to deserve that life? Well, if he had to go through it, because from there, if he did not go to the well, he wouldn't have been picked up by the travelers. If he was not picked up by the travelers, he wouldn't have gone to Egypt. If he did not go to Egypt, he would not have been sold as a slave. If he did not become a slave in the king's house, then what's going to happen? he wouldn't have ended up in the prison. He wouldn't have been accused and ended up in prison. If he did not go to the prison, he would not have given the interpretation of the dream to those two people. And if he did not give that dream, interpretation of those dreams, then he wouldn't have gone to the king as a finance minister. He wouldn't have become the finance minister. If he did not become the finance minister of Egypt, then thousands and thousands and thousands of people would have died for 7 years from famine. Agreed? Yes, that would have happened. And for him, he had to go through all those things in his life so that one day he can sit on top of the throne of Egypt and help thousands and thousands of people to the point that people from Canaan, even his own brothers, come around to get this food. And he gave that idea of preserving 7 years of corn and then 7 years of giving it up, right? Wow, amazing wisdom of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He was making dua throughout, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had some wisdom for him. So when you and me go through difficulties in life, you should never ever question, why is this happening to us? Whatever happened, you should be satisfied with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's decision. قَدَّرَ اللَّهُ مَا شَاءَ فَعَلَ. This is the qadr of Allah. He does whatever He wants. رَضِيتُ بِاللَّهِ رَبًّا. I am satisfied with Rabb. Allah is my Rabb. Whatever He does, whatever You do with me, Allah, I'm satisfied. And dua is a request, not an order. Dua is a request, not an order. It's a request you're giving to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the way He accepts what He does, He gets that request and He makes it better and gives it to you. And that's why the Prophet says, dua can also change qadr. Dua can change qadr. That you make dua, right? And all the bad things supposed to happen in that year can be prevented. Dua, because of your dua, you may be guided. Allah, it was written in the qadr that if you make dua, then you will be guided. If you didn't make dua, you will be misguided. So you made the dua, and therefore the qadr was changed. So dua is so powerful that it can also change qadr. Now, how do I make dua? What's the best way of making dua? The best way of making dua is the way the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam made dua. Right? He came to teach us how to do ibadah. And so the best way to make dua, here are some, you can make dua anytime, but here are some things that will help you. There's more chance of your dua being accepted. Number one is making wudu. Be in a state of wudu when you make dua, in state of ritual purity. Number two is face the qibla. It helps when you face the qibla. And then the first thing when you begin is you begin by praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Any dua of praise, that's why you begin Fatiha. Fatiha is what? Begins with praise, Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. You can begin with Fatiha too, Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen, Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim, Malik Yawmiddin, Iyaka Na'budu, Iyaka Nasta'in. Like the first three ayat, actually your dua, and then you get to your dua, which is Ihdina Salat Al-Mustaqeem. You see? Praising Allah first. The next thing you do is, you send salawat and Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. You send salawat and Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Allahumma salli wa sallam ala Nabiyyina Muhammad, or Durud Ibrahim. Then you make dua for yourself. Qu anfusakum. Protect yourself. First, you make dua for yourself. And when you make dua for yourself, here's the thing. You should not avoid making specific duas. Don't make specific duas. Make duas that are general. Because the Prophet ﷺ made general dua. You should ask dua in such a way that, Ya Allah, if you think this is good for me, make it happen. And the best example is dua istikhara. Dua istikhara, everybody should do it. Right? To the point the Sahaba say, the Prophet says, even if you have to get a shoelace, you lost your shoelace, or you have to get a new one, make istikhara. Right? Most people make istikhara and make big decisions when they're going to get married or going to get a job or something. But make istikhara for everything you do, any decisions you do. Istikhara comes from the word khayr, goodness. Istikhara means to seek the goodness from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Seek the good, right, from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So how does the dua go? Allahumma inni astakhiruka bi'ilmik. Oh Allah, I ask you for the good from your ilm. وَأَسْتَقْدِرُكَ بِقُدْرَتِكَ. I ask you from your power. وَأَسْأَلُكَ مِنْ فَضْلِكَ الْعَظِيمِ. I ask you by your great bounty. وَأَسْأَلُكَ مِنْ فَضْلِكَ الْعَظِيمِ. اللَّهُمَّ إِنِّي أَسْتَخِرُكَ بِعِلْمِكَ وَأَسْتَقْدِرُكَ بِقُدْرَتِكَ وَأَسْأَلُكَ مِنْ فَضْلِكَ الْعَظِيمِ. اللَّهُمَّ إِنْ كُنْتَ تَعْلَمْ أَنَّ هَذَا الْأَمْرَ خَيْرٌ لِي فِي دِينِي وَمَعَاشِي وَعَاقِبَةِ أَمْرِي فَقَدِّرْهُ لِي وَيَسِّرْهُ لِي ثُمَّ بَارِكْ لِي فِيهِ. So he says, Ya Allah, if you know that this thing that I'm about to do, make the intention, if you know that this thing, this marriage, this job, this house, this this car, or this course, this degree, whatever it is. If you know that this is good for me, then make it. This is good for me, my deen, my dunya, and my akhirah. Beautiful. This is good for me, my deen, my dunya, my akhirah, and for my family. Then make it happen for me. Make it easy for me and bless me in it. And وَإِن كُنْتَ تَعْلَمْ أَنَّ هَذَا الْأَمْرَ شَرٌّ لِّي فِي دِينِي وَمَعَاشِي وَعَاقِبَةِ أَمْرِي فَقَدِّرْهُ لِي وَاصْرِفْهُ عَنِّي وَاصْرِفْنِي عَنْهُ وَقَدِّرْ لِي الْخَيْرَ حَيْثُ كَانَ ثُمَّ أَرْضِنِي بِهِ. And if you know that this dua, this thing that I'm about to do is bad for me, my deen, my dunya, and my akhirah, for my family, then take it away from me and take me away from it. Divert it away from me, Allah. Make it difficult. Take it away from me so that I don't have any interest for it. And bless me with something which is better than this, wherever it may be. Allahu Akbar. Beautiful dua to have anytime you make dua. So first thing is make dua for yourself. Then you make dua for your family, and then you make dua for the rest of the ummah. That's the sequence of making dua. So, there was a poor sahabi, he came to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, says, Ya Rasulullah, make dua that, I become rich. Like, I get this job, I become rich. He was very poor, used to pray five times, alhamdulillah. And then he comes to Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and says, Ya Rasulullah, make dua that I become rich. Prophet says, it's not a good dua for you. Should not. No, Ya Rasulullah, I know it's better for me. Please make dua for me. Prophet says, no, it's not good for you. Ask Allah for something that is good for you. Say, Ya Allah, whatever you think is good for me, make me happy. Right? Don't ask for specific things, because you don't know what's good for you or what's bad for you. So, he comes and says, Ya Rasulullah, make dua. Okay then, the Prophet makes dua for him, that he becomes rich, and that's what happens, he becomes rich. And what happens then, he gets so occupied, he gets his sheep and all that, becomes huge, and he becomes so occupied, he became so rich that he stopped attending jama'ah. He couldn't come to salah anymore, right? He was so occupied with his business. And then what happens, slowly, eventually, what happens is the Prophet to the point that he doesn't even give zakah. He became so greedy also that he doesn't even give zakah. And the Prophet leaves this world, and this person, after the Prophet's death, he actually leaves Islam. What's the point? I have everything. What's the point of akhir? I have everything here. Nothing. Like when you have wealth, you become arrogant. Antabida hadihi abada. The same person says in Surah Al-Kahf that, I don't think this will ever perish. Look at that. Like such a huge garden, such a huge business. I don't think this will ever come to an end. And what happens? So he leaves Islam and he dies as a murtad, as a non-Muslim. Allahu Akbar. What happened? Right? Just because you think this is good for you, it's not actually good for you. You have to ask Allah, Ya Allah, whatever you think is good for me, make that happen to me. And here's the thing, never be impatient with your dua. Never be impatient with the dua. And the Prophet ﷺ says, the dua of any worshipper will be responded as long as he's not hasty and impatient. As long as he's not hasty and impatient. And the Prophet and the companions ask, Ya Rasulullah, how can a person be impatient? And the Prophet says, the one who says, I have made dua, but I see that Allah has not responded. I kept making dua for one whole week, nothing happened. And those prophets make dua for hundreds of years, right? He says, I made dua for so many days, nothing happened, so I just stopped making the dua. It's the worst thing you can do. It's the worst thing, Allah hates that. And that's the kind of person whose duas are never accepted. And you look at Zakariya alayhi salam. He was really, really old. وَاشْتَعْلَ رَأْسُ شَيْبًا. That my hair has turned grey, and my wife is old and barren, and I need a child, Ya Allah. I need a child. Bless me with a child, Ya Allah. And so why? He wanted a child so that child can take on his legacy. Right? He was a prophet. He needed someone who can take on his legacy of prophethood and continue teaching the people. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala responds to Zakariya alayhi salam as he is praying, angels descend. Says, Zakariya, your dua has been answered. We will give you Yahya, which is to give life. He thought that his legacy will come to an end, will die. He says, we'll give you Yahya. His name will be Yahya, someone who gives life, and he'll revive your legacy and continue for the rest of your life. And his dua was answered. No matter what it is, he was old. Scientifically, it's not possible to reproduce at that time, at that age. And Allah says, قَالَ كَذَلِكَ. We can do whatever we want. It's easy. It's easy on us. كُنْ فَيَكُنْ إِذَا قَضَى أَمْرًا فَإِنَّمَا يَقُولَ كُنْ فَيَكُنْ. He says كُنْ. He says be and becomes. That's it. Right? Allah can do whatever He wants. And He can give whoever He wants, whatever He wants without any hisab. Well, what you need to have is you need to have certainty in your dua. Ikhlas. A person who makes dua need to have this firm yaqeen, Allah will answer this dua. If you have a dua like, I don't know, I'm just making it, that dua is not accepted. There should be full ikhlas in your heart that Allah is my Rabb. Allah listens to me, He's listening to me as I speak right now, and He will answer. If not today, later. If it's not good for me, He will not make it happen. That's okay. Whatever happens, I'm satisfied with it. And you look, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also answered shaitan. Allah even responds to shaitan. Shaitan knew that Allah responds to du'as. Even he makes du'a to Allah. Ya Allah, give me some time. Give me some time till the day of judgment. What does Allah say? إِنَّكَ مِنَ الْمُنْظَرِينَ. Go. We have been given respite. Even if Allah can answer shaitan, how about you and me? Why do we feel that? When what we need to have is yaqeen and never be impatient when we make dua. قول قولي هذا واستغفر الله لي ولكم ولسائر المسلمين فاستغفروا إنه الغفور الرحيم. Alhamdulillah, wassalatu wassalamu ala rasulillah wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa wala. So one day Imam Ahmad bin Hanbal rahimahullah, he was traveling. He used to travel and gain knowledge. So one day he was traveling and he didn't have a place to stay, so he wanted to sleep in the masjid. So he goes in the masjid, the guards did not let him sleep, right? He tried to sleep like around the masjid, even that guard did not let him sleep there. So he was like, you know, he didn't have any place to sleep. And so what happens, he was just on the streets, right? And then a baker was just passing by, he sees this poor man sleeping on the road. And so he gets him to his house, right? And so this baker, you know, he lives. So Imam Ahmad bin Hanbal sees this person, right? This baker, what a righteous life he was living, right? He used to pray tahajjud, eat halal food, you know, all of these things. And so Imam Ahmad bin Hanbal, he asked this person, you know, like, what do you think, what is the benefit, like, how has your life changed, and what is the benefit of you living this life, right? And so, this baker says, you know, because he used to eat halal food and pray, right? And because of this, he says, my du'as are never rejected. Because of my life that like this, my du'as are never rejected. But he says, there's one dua that I'm making to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, I'm still waiting for that answer. And so Imam Ahmad bin Hanbal says, what is that? Tell me what is that? And so this baker says, for a very long time I was making dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make me meet Imam Ahmad bin Hanbal. And he didn't know this, he had never seen Imam Ahmad bin Hanbal. And so Ahmad bin Hanbal says, congratulations, right? Your dua has been answered. I am Imam Ahmad bin Hanbal. Allahu Akbar. Okay, that's a true story, right? Ahmad, what do we see here? Halal food. Halal, one of the reasons why our du'as will not be accepted is halal, is haram food. Haram food, right? A person, the Prophet says, will go for Hajj, will do all the effort, go near the Kaaba, he's raising hands to Allah and making du'a, his du'a will be rejected. Why? Because how can a person answer someone who eats haram, who wears haram, who lives under haram? Anna yustajabu lah. How can Allah answer this person? A person who does not have a halal business, who does not earn halal, that person's dua will not be accepted. That's why dua is rejected in this haram food. Right? That's what's important, especially for the breadwinners of the house, to make sure you bring halal food to the house. Right? And because of haram food, you will see that amilu salihat will not happen. Ya ayyuha rusul kulu min at-tayyibat wa amalu salihah. Connection is, O prophets, eat halal food and do righteous deeds. If there's no halal food, there is no dua, there's no righteous deeds, there's nothing. Right? The du'as are never answered for a person who does not eat halal. And when we make dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you can use tawassul to make dua. Tawassul means to use Allah, use some mediary to make dua. Not a person, but something. Ya Allah, you use Allah's names, for example. Ya Allah, you are Ghafoor, forgive me. Ya Allah, you are Wahhab, you are the one who provide me. Whatever request you have, you will find the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for that. Whatever you're asking, if you're asking for rizq, you say, Ya Razzaq, Urzuqni. Ya Wahhab. If you ask me for a child, you use the word Wahhab. Ya Wahhab. Habli. Right? You ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for forgiveness. Ya Ghafoor, Ighfirli. Ya Ra'uf, Urfu'bi. Right? Whatever dua you make, you should make use Allah's names to make dua for that. Right? And that's a good way to have our du'as accepted. Another way to have our du'as accepted is using our good deeds. Using our good deeds. So we say, Ya Allah, that day I did such and such thing only for your sake. Ya Allah, if you think that is, you know, something that you want to reward me with, Ya Allah, please take me away from this difficulty. And just the last thing I'll share, there were three people who were traveling, the famous story in Riyadhus Salihin. There were three people who were traveling and they got stuck. They got into a cave and there's a huge boulder that came at the entrance and blocked them. They couldn't go out, they were blocked. And so what happens then, these three people, each one of them makes dua through tawassul, through their good deeds. So what happens, one of the person says, Ya Allah, this, you know, I used to take care of my parents to the point that one day I came back home and I brought some food and my parents were hungry and they went to sleep. Just for hunger, they were waiting for me, I didn't come, they went to sleep. And then I didn't want to give this food to my child and my wife, so I waited for them to wake up and I put my child to sleep and I made my wife wait until I give this food to my parents. Until my parents don't eat, they can't eat. So I waited for them, Ya Allah, until they got up. And so when they got up, I fed them first, then I fed my family. Ya Allah, if you think this, I did it for your sake, Ya Allah, help us, help us in this difficulty. So the rocks move a little bit. And so it wasn't enough for them to get up. So what we see here is that preferring your parents, it's very common to have natural love towards your wife, towards your, you know, towards the husband or to the children, right? It's natural. But you have to go above and beyond, out of your way to, you know, love and respect and take care of your parents. And so that's what a good deed that actually move this boulder a little bit. Another person makes dua, Ya Allah, I used to love this woman so much. I always wanted to had a relationship with her, and so this situation came up, and you know, her and me were alone, and I was about to approach her. Right then, she says, "Fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala." And you know, I was in that zone. I just left, Ya Allah, just for your sake, fearing you. Ya Allah, if you think this I did only for your sake, and control myself for your sake, Ya Allah, help us in this difficulty. So the rock moved a bit more. And then finally, third person makes a dua. Ya Allah, this person came and he gave me some money, and then I was alone, I was supposed to return him. But he just went somewhere, so I couldn't return that money. But I used that money, I invested on things, and that money multiplied, right? From one sheep value became like 1,000 sheep. It multiplied so much. And many years later, he came and asked for that money, and since that money multiplied so much, I used that money to multiply so much, I gave all of that for your sake. That is justice, right? He gave all of that, you know, to that person. And so he says, Ya Allah, if you think this is for you, I did it for your sake, Ya Allah, move this rock away from me, away from us. And then that rock moves and they go out of the cave. So what we see is that when you make dua, you can use tawassul, use your good deeds to make dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So when you make dua, final thing I'll say, one of three things can happen. Right, when you make dua, one of three things can happen. Number one, the dua happens right away. You make dua like right now, and you go out, you see it. Say Allahu Akbar. Right? Dua can manifest immediately. Second thing that can happen is that the dua prevents a person from harm. Some accident was supposed to happen, but because of dua, you were prevented from that. Some you're about to lose a job or something, but because of that, you were protected. Whatever it is, you were protected from some harm because of the dua. That's the second thing that can happen. And the third thing that can happen is really beautiful, is that du'as are not given. This du'a is not accepted in this dunya. Rather, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes a beautiful garden for us in Jannah, and He gives this beautiful, you know, garden. And we ask Allah, Ya Allah, what is this for? And Allah says, this is for all the du'as you have made. For every du'a you have made, and it wasn't accepted in this dunya, it was preserved, a seed was planted in Jannah, and this is the beautiful thing, this is a gift I've given you. And at that time, the person will say, I wish none of my du'as were accepted in this dunya. I wish none of my du'as were manifested in this dunya. That's the right word to use. They are accepted, but the way it manifests. I wish none of my du'as came true in this dunya. Right? That's a beauty, that any dua you make is never rejected. So increase in your dua, and Allah is above that. So the brother requested me to make dua for her sister, inshallah, so we'll conclude the khutbah with a beautiful dua. Okay? اللهم لك الحمد أنت نور السماوات والأرض من فيهن ولك الحمد أنت قيوم السماوات والأرض من فيهن ولك الحمد أنت الحق ووعدك الحق وقولك الحق ولقاؤك حق والجنة حق والنار حق والساعة حق والنبيون حق اللهم لك أسلمنا وعليك توكلنا وإليك أنبنا وبك خاصمنا وإليك حاكمنا فاغفر لنا ما قدمنا وما أخرنا وما أسررنا وما أعلنا وما أنت أعلم به منا أنت المقدم وأنت المؤخر لا إله إلا أنت اللهم اقسم لنا من خشيتك ما تحول به بيننا وبين معصيتك ومن طاعتك ما تبلغنا به جنتك ومن اليقين ما تهون به علينا مصائب الدنيا ومتعنا اللهم بأسماعنا وأبصارنا وقواتنا أبدا ما أحييتنا واجعله الوارث منا واجعل ثأرنا على من ظلمنا وانصرنا على من عادانا ولا تجعل مصيبتنا في ديننا ولا تجعل الدنيا أكبر همنا ولا مبلغ علمنا ولا إلى النار مصيرنا ولا تسلط علينا من لا يخافك فينا ولا يرحمنا برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين اللهم اغفر لحيتنا وميتنا وشاهدنا وغائبنا وصغيرنا وكبيرنا وذكرنا وأنثانا اللهم من أحييته منا فأحيي على الإيمان ومن توفيته منا فتوفه على الإسلام اللهم اشف مرضانا ومرضى المسلمين اللهم ارحم موتانا ومرحم مسلمين عباد الله يرحمكم الله إن الله يأمر بالعدل والإحسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر والبغي يعظكم لعلكم تذكرون اذكروا الله العظيم يذكركم واشكروا وعلى نعمه يزدكم ولذكر الله أكبر والله يعلم ما تصنعون. We have some announcements, inshallah. So some announcements, inshallah. So as you can see, the other unit is also rented. So the operational costs have actually doubled. So we request all the people to